episode 10.
This is episode 10. It's a really big episode.
I know. Well, it's like 10's a nice round number, and we've made it 10 episodes, and we've covered a lot of ground, and there's still so much more ground left to cover.
It's unbelievable. Well, it was funny because I was speaking with one of our guests this morning about today's topic, and they were saying, you know, how are we going to cover all of this in like 45 minutes? I'm like, no, no, no. What we do here on the podcast is we scrape the surface, realize that there are a thousand other things we could dive into, and then save it for later. So
there's sort of an infinity pool. I'm going to say there's an infinity pool of approaches and material here on Out of Touch, a Hall and Oates podcast. And I say that partly because I have just returned from Kauai, although my hotel was rather a low budget hotel. It did not have an infinity pool, but I did want to tell you one thing that I did. That's related to the podcast. As you know, you and I have tickets coming up in May. We may or may not have various tickets, but I'm pretty sure that we have tickets.
We do have tickets. I purchased said tickets.
In May, I owe you some money, to see Daryl Hall with Todd Rundgren.
Yes.
Who is a musician who plays multiple instruments, who's played with many people, who's produced music. And he happens to own a tiki bar in Kauai.
See, and that I did not know.
Few people know this, but the guidebook of Kauai does know this. And so I actually, you know, I wasn't seeking out Todd Rundgren. And to be clear, he doesn't work at the tiki bar.
Although he's on tour with Daryl Hall.
He's on tour. Yeah, he's probably usually behind the bar. The host was an elderly, very tanned man who showed me to some of the portraits of Todd Rundgren, and I've taken pictures, and you put those up on the website. He offered to pose as Todd Rundgren, but I thought that the portraits on the wall were going to be enough. So yeah. Anyway, that is my that's my Hall and Oates update from Kauai, and I'm just kind of letting the vacation keep on going a little bit by having a little Malibu, a little coconut rum.
Yes, and Coke. Gotta love that coconut rum.
This is left over from our last guest, Alexandra Friedman Smith, Esquire.
Esquire.
The third.
What kind of coconut rum do you have? I have the Selvaray coconut rum.
Ah, you have the Selvaray,
which comes from Silk Sonic, because I love them so much.
I know. Don't you like how we do all this like free product placement? Well, my rum is Malibu rum.
Well, because honestly, like the Malibu and Coke is way more high school, which today's episode is brought to you by high school.
Exactly why I did it. Well, first I wasn't going to drink, because I was going to be like, don't drink, kids. But, you know, we are going to have two experts coming in. Maybe you want to sort of orient our listeners to what the heck we're going to do today.
This is a high concept episode. This is a little bit of an experiment. So,
and it's also going to be a shorter episode.
And that will also be an experiment. We're going to try to cut ourselves off. So basically I watch Euphoria with my children. Well, one of my children, which is a controversial topic in and of itself, for which I was interviewed in the New York Times, and I will have to share that article with you. But my kids watch Euphoria. I watch Euphoria because my kids watch it. It's a really interesting show. But this season, there was a heavy Hall and Oates vibe happening. There was an episode titled Out of Touch. They use Method of Modern Love. They use Do What You Want, Be What You Want. And so I couldn't help but notice that had to be intentional, and did a little diving into, you know, the people who do the music, and have a theory on why those songs are involved in this season. So we can get into that when our guests get here.
I'm really excited to hear about your theory, and I'm really excited for our guests. Are they in the waiting room yet?
They are in the waiting room.
Oh, I'm in the garage.
Before I allow our guests in, I want to add one thing, which is going to be the most interesting part of this conversation, which is that listeners, Naomi has not watched Euphoria. Except for a collection of scenes, which I put together for her specifically related to my theory.
So yeah, I don't even think you needed to say that, because it's going to become screamingly evident shortly that I did the Cliff Notes version and I'm likely to fail the exam. but you know, with the help of some tutors today, I'm hoping I can at least get a passing grade.
Our whole thing with the Hall and Oates podcast is we're always learning. We're listening, we're learning, we're exploring, and we can't see everything, we can't hear everything, and we can't know everything, and we don't claim to.
Yeah, this is like that nightmare where you realize you were in a class and then it's the final, and then you're like, oh my God, I haven't even been attending, and you show up at the final and you're naked. And it's a nightmare.
I have that dream often. All the time, still, even though I haven't taken a class that mattered for years.
I am in remedial euphoria, and you guys are in the AP. Let's bring in our A students.
Okay, let me call my students. They're supposed to be here.
Are they going to get tardies?
They're going to get tardies.
Oh, I'll keep sipping on this. You know, while we wait for them to come, I actually wanted to talk about the music of our featured song.
Hold on. Will you come? Will you also put the dogs inside the house, please, and give them ears?
Definitely.
Tell Hazel to come.
Don't edit that out. That's so good. Give the dogs ears. Do it. I want to talk about, so the song I think that you thought that we would center on is Do What You Want, Be What You Are.
Yeah.
1976, the Bigger Than Both of Us album. Before we get into Euphoria, I just want to say I never heard the song before and I really like it. And I'm analyzing why I like it, and I know why I like it. And I like it because the bass is jamming. It's just got that solid bass. It's so good.
It's a great song. And it's one of those songs that if you didn't know it was a Hall & Oates song and you didn't know their voices, you probably wouldn't even realize it, because it's back from the 70s, back from that whole situation.
Super 70s. And the string, it was like the bass, and then there's like an orchestral stuff, like some violins. It's so good. Yeah. So it's just great. A good and song.
I actually have one Oates quote that I'll drop on you right now while we wait for our guests. So John Oates, one of the kings, said, "Do what you want, be what you are," which is a deep cut from the 1976 album. Encapsulates the duo's career aesthetic. That, Oates said, is exactly who we are.
I also just like the lyrics of the song are just really good. They're kind of like empowering. Yes. I mean, there is a little stuff about, I'm like, what are you getting into here with leather bars? But anyway. Well,
that's part of what we're going to talk about.
You can bring that up.
I'm going to bring that up. Okay, here's our guests.
Oh my goodness.
Arriving.
Are the guests of honor here? Hello.
Hello.
Very good to see you both.
Good to see you as well.
I set us up on a bench. So
hey,
we can
You're not our guest today.
NATO wants to be a guest too.
I know. Laughing boys always trying to get in on the scene.
Okay. Is anybody going to play piano, Naomi?
Well, NATO decided it'd be a great idea to just play television real loud. Why don't you introduce our guests?
I would like to introduce our guests this week. My children are here. I have two of them. I have Hazel. She uses she, her pronouns, and she's 18. She's my kid that's getting ready to go off to college. And then I have my other kid, Sid, who's here, who uses they, he pronouns. And they are 15 going on 16 and not going to college soon. Hopefully.
Great.
You're going to go to college. She just can't handle thinking about it.
I'm going to college. I was like,
But you know what? Vocational school is great. Anyway.
Great. Totally great.
Yeah, just for people who choose that, right? It's a valid path for some.
Absolutely. 100%. There's too much pressure put on these kids, but that's a whole other episode.
Okay. I know you have a whole agenda, but can I just open it up with questions for Sid and Hazel? Just like, you know that I don't watch Euphoria. I did a little homework, right? I watched some of it for the first time yesterday. Mm-hmm. This is my challenge to you and whoever wants to take the spoon or the spear first. if you could do like a 60-second, you know, 60-second summary. I don't know about you guys. My children are horrific at summarization, but you guys are a little older. You have the 60-second for the alien who just landed. What is this show?
not even about the 60 seconds. It's that there's so much that happens that I don't even think it would fit in 60 seconds.
Okay. But what I want to hear is just from each of you, like, what comes out? You have 60 seconds. That's actually a long time.
The first season or the second season? Because the second season the Hall and Oates songs.
I'm just saying, like, the big picture of the entire show, and I'm going to time you, and you're starting right now, and you have to start, Sid, because you started. Here we go. What's this about? I'm an alien.
So it basically follows the lives of these students at this school, and they're going through changes, and they have, like, it's about drug abuse, and, there's sexual assault, and just all of the major issues that are dealt with maybe by some students in high school, and it follows all of these different characters and their lives. And our main character is Rue. I mean, they're all kind of main characters in their own ways, but it's from Rue's perspective, who is the main character, who is a major drug addict. And so everything that is told on the show is necessarily, like, we don't know if it's necessarily true because it's told from her perspective while she was on drugs. So we're just kind of trusting what she's saying. And it's from her perspective. So that's pretty interesting. Hazel, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, I would say it's also a lot about relationships, both inter and interpersonal relationships, and how, not just in high school, but also, exploring, I guess, the relationship between drug addicts and their families. Specifically looking at, like, a teenager and seeing how that affects not only her, but and her perception of reality, but also, like, her sibling and her mother, and kind of just, like, the ripple effect that drug abuse has on everyone surrounding the individual. So I think that's a big part of it too, that, like, brings a lot of awareness, but it definitely raises some issues and conversations as well.
Yeah.
That's super awesome. You guys did such a good job explaining that. I'm just going to chime in with one thing. Just, it has nothing to do with Euphoria, but, like, my principal job is as a nurse practitioner, and my kind of newer work is with street medicine and working with people who have had recent overdoses. And I've learned a lot over the past, year or two of doing this work. And one of the things that I have learned that's making me change my language a little bit is change my language away from using the term drug addict. And that's sort of in the same way that I've learned from the people that I've worked with and the people that I'm working with, that I'm moving away from saying, for example, homeless people, because both of those kinds of terms, like, describe the, and it's like the same reason why we try to no longer say a diabetic, because all of those things describe the person as this, as sort of foreground. Oh, and I'm going to start getting all the tech.
So what kind of terminology are you using? This is great for us, but also for everybody listening.
Yeah.
People who use drugs.
Yep. People who use drugs, just like people who experience homelessness.
Exactly. I'm going to try to tell my child, I have to try to tell my child not to text me, but then suddenly my keyboard switched to Hebrew and it's going right to left. And so the deleting isn't working. I don't even know. No text.
Is it writing no text in Hebrew?
I have no idea. My children did do their batei mitzvah this year, but I didn't get any Hebrew out of it. I'm like a bad. I am a Jew, but I'm like a bad Jew. I have to say that I'm a Jew because it's come up several times when Mary Kay says the word Jew and then thinks that she can't say the word Jew. I have to represent as a Jew to say that you can say the word Jew.
I'm here to tell you, in my defense, I said it one day this week and one of my kids was like, Mom, you can't say that. And I was like, Naomi says I can say it.
I think the way it's used feels derogatory.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. No,
people be like, these Jews or something like that. Sorry.
Yeah. No, and you know what? Like, it might even be something related to what we're just talking about, because it's like, it depends on how you're using it, right? So
right.
There are people who are Jewish, people who identify as Jewish. Anyway, let's dive in to this is a mini episode. We're going to keep it short and sweet. What the heck is even going on with Hall and Oates and Euphoria?
So here's the thing with Hall and Oates, and this is, it's one of those things that when this happened, we thought about it a lot, and we wanted to just scratch the surface on this because we want to let people sort of think about it on their own, people who've watched the shows. And anyone who wants to have a conversation about this with me, I would love to interact with you on any of the socials, so hit us up. So basically, there is an episode 2, season 2, which is called Out of Touch, which is obviously brought about by Hall and Oates. And then there's 2 songs that are used, which is the Do What You Want, Be What You Are, and Method of Modern Love. Now, if you look at the themes in both of those songs, they both have to deal with, interpersonal, complicated interpersonal relationships and authentic selves, right? So to me, this all boils down to one character on the show, Cal. And so what I did is I sent Naomi several scenes from season 2 that kind of show Cal's journey. And Cal is basically, father, an older man, probably similar to our age.
Young man. He's a father, but like he got started really young, right? Like, cause he was still like, he was like 18 when he, becomes a father basically.
Right. So basically,
he's actually younger than us if you think about it.
Yeah.
but we're way better preserved.
Talk about that. So, Cal basically, what Cal goes through and what I thought would be interesting to talk to the kids about is so Cal, back in the 90s, is basically in love with his best friend, right? Who is another man. And, sort of discovers this about himself with his friend. And then pretty much immediately afterwards finds out that his girlfriend is pregnant, who he then marries and goes on to have other children with. And then we find the Cal that we know in modern day Euphoria, who is a closeted gentleman who meets people on Tinder and sleeps with them in hotels.
Well,
Grindr. Yeah. Mm-hmm. He meets people on Grindr and sleeps with them in hotels.
And videos it without
and their videos permission. It without their permission. But, yeah. Which is a whole other layer.
Yeah.
So he's not a very likable character as an adult. You can understand why he's bitter, but like that, I just saw that scene where he's drunk driving and then he goes to the bar and tries to wrestle and
that's kind of his
Did he, what happened to his head? I missed why his head was in a bandage.
So he basically found out that someone had taken one of the videos that he had of him having sex with one of the Euphoria characters who is below 18, which he didn't know. And so he was like, oh no, that's going to ruin my life. So he went to these people who he thought had the disc and he was just kind of sitting there and they were hitting him in the head with a gun.
I don't know why we're laughing.
There's so much happening. I don't have time to explain.
Well, because it's like, the image you described was like, he just goes there and he's quiet and he sits down and they start hitting him.
They're trying to get information out of him. And one of the guys is just like, bah. Whenever he doesn't really
with the butt of a gun. And by guy, you mean a child.
A child
named Ashtray.
Ashtray.
So basically, season 2, episode 2 is titled Out of Touch. And my theory on that is that the final scene of that is basically Cal learning from his son that somebody has this tape. And he's so out of touch with what's happening around him that all he suddenly is focused on is, I got to get this DVD back. And that kind of starts this whole series of events that you saw with the flashback to his childhood and then the epic foyer scene where he's like screaming at his children and his wife and peeing on the floor, which although beautifully written is incredibly traumatic for everyone involved.
I have to say also that episode reminded me that I read an article recently about a man whose job it is to design the penis prosthetics. That it seems that most people who are showing their penises now are actually using a prosthetic. And so there are people whose livelihood is creating these molds. So right. I was just thinking about, I bet that's a penis prosthetic right there.
It was a penis prosthetic. And I read about it because I think it's fascinating that men are using penis prosthetics, yet when women appear nude in film, no one's using boob prosthetics.
Exactly. Of course, that's the first thing I thought about. Okay. All right. Let's get back into this.
Carrying on. I think obviously, if you look at the lyrics of Do What You Want, Be What You Are, it, to me, it really gives the vibe of, you know, being trapped in a persona that you don't feel authentic in. Right. You know,
well, and you, you didn't put this on the homework assignment, but I did extra credit. And because the scene, I was like, well, this whole thing, like, you didn't put this part in my homework assignment. And so the song "Do What You Want, Be Who You Are" is actually in a different with this other. It's with what are they? Evan and
Kat. And so Kat. Basically, the reason I didn't share that with you was Ethan, right?
Ethan,
because Kat's whole thing is that she's in a similar situation to Cal, but in a different version of it, in that she's in a relationship with an exceptionally nice guy named Ethan.
And she wants a barbarian.
She
so wants Cal Drogo.
Yeah. So she's living in this, I mean, who doesn't, but she's living in this existence of trying to be someone that she's not with this person that she doesn't want to be with, which is not unlike what Cal is doing, right? You know, he's being this person that he's not and living with people that he doesn't want to be with, not because he doesn't like them, but because, you know, it's not who he authentically is. So it's, you know, and I think it's interesting. I mean, even for a song that came out of the 70s, you know, they're mentioning leather bars, movie stars, you know, they're kind of getting into it, which would indicate, you know, authenticity, right? And especially having to do with your sexuality, which was something, especially in the 70s, that was very kind of, you know, even with Bowie and everything else that was going on, it was still kind of like a subject that was a little taboo to discuss. So
I'm curious for Sid and Hazel, like, you know, this, it's, it, the episodes that I watched, you know, that have both Do What You Want, Be Who You Are, Be What You Are, and Method of Modern Love, there were other songs from the 80s and 90s. There was a couple of In Excess songs. There was an Erasure song. There was there was actually a lot of good old stuff. Like, and I was like, what is this? What's this time period of this? What do you guys think of that music when it's coming on to like this TV show, which so speaks to, you know, contemporary issues for young people? This music's old. Like, are you like, ugh, why is this old music on?
No, I think every time they used, like when they did use the two Hall and Oates songs, it like fit really well. Like, I think that was a really great choice.
Yeah, I think Labyrinth scored the whole thing very well. And I think, I mean, I, you know, you could go the route too of being like the 80s are coming back kind of thing. I think a lot of kids listen to 80s music and are very into 80s fashion and like early 90s fashion right now. But I don't know.
Yeah, like that ponytail you have right there. Like,
Yeah.
I used to rock that.
Coming down. Yeah, exactly.
And I think part of that is I read an article from the music supervisor, Jen Malone, who, you know, she and Labyrinth and the creator, Sam Levinson, worked together really closely to make sure that every song choice was intentional, right? And I do
Sam Levinson sounds Jewish, by the way.
It's possible, yes. And so they wanted to make everything very intentional, but they also mentioned, which I thought was interesting, and I think the kids can speak to this too, that, you know, because of TikTok, a lot of these old songs are showing up, you know, like I'll hear them listening to something and I'm like, how did you find out about that song? You know, and they'll say, oh, TikTok. So I think that that's a big thing that's happening on TikTok too, is kids are listening to these like 70s, 80s, 90s, early 2000s songs that otherwise they wouldn't really be, except for the fact that, you know, you and I at home listen to all of them and they have to hear it anyway, yeah. But they wouldn't necessarily be picking up by themselves.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool.
Access to internet too.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, speaking on TikTok, right? Like the access to internet and having kind of, I mean, being able to listen to like a wide variety of music from any decade is super powerful. And I like how Euphoria kind of utilized that, even though it was a timepiece, but even when it wasn't during the time period, they continued to use music from other decades. And I appreciated that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like, especially if you watch the Sinead O'Connor, the Drink Before the War song, you know, when Cal's kind of falling apart and Sinead O'Connor is playing, but they're also showing, you know, this other character, Cassie, kind of completely falling apart
and lip syncing to the song. I loved that.
Yeah. So they're weaving it sort of in and out of the flashbacks and the modern times. And I think it speaks to the fact that like music is kind of timeless, you know, and you can, I mean, you know, we listen to all kinds of stuff now that's from long ago, you know, the Temptations or, you know, whatever, Nat King Cole, like all that stuff. We're still listening to that now because it's just good music.
Right, there's that whole scene where Zendaya is like lip syncing to, I think it's Frank Sinatra.
Fly Me to the Moon.
It wasn't at the...
That was in the first season.
Well, what I saw is that Call Me Irresponsible. That was, right? That's a good one. So good. That's a good
one. And just so much, you know, new music, old music, all together played side by side. And that was one of the things too, that one of them said in one of the articles that I read, I think it was Labyrinth, that said, you know, they're creating playlists for people that where they have, you know, a song from the 70s next to a song from last week, next to a song from the 80s, next to a song from a year ago, next to, you know, and these sort of timeless playlists because of, you know, because of the lyrical content is still relevant. And the, you know, like you said, when you listen to Do What You Want, Be What You Are, it's like, it's a good song. Like it's got a groove to it.
It's an excellent song. So vibey, as Chloe would say. Well, I'd like to have, I'd love for Sid and Hazel to chime in and see what they think about your theory, Mary Kay. And, you know, and if you have any, you know, if you think that her theory is valid, and if you want to modify it or offer, or, you know, put forth your own theory about, what's going on in the importance, if there is anything beyond superficial importance, which Mary Kay is alluding to with the Hall and Oates and Euphoria, what you think it is, if you think it's, you know, the Cal thing or anything else. Yeah, pop quiz.
I can talk about that. I was listening to the song just an hour ago. And so for Do What You Want, Be Who You Are, I think it was talking a lot about authenticity. And we kind of touched on that earlier with, you know, Kat and Ethan's relationship. And in addition to Cal too, of like, you know, these people are not being their most authentic selves, you know, and do what you want, be who you are, right?
I keep having to look back at the title. I'm like,
do what you want, be who you are.
Be what you are.
Not do what you want, be what you want.
It's hard.
Be what you are.
Do what you want, be who you are.
Be what you are.
What you who. Do what you be.
Be what you are.
Be what you are.
Okay. All right. No, let's. Sorry, Hazel.
I have it written down. That's why. Continue. Be what you are. Sorry. There we go. Okay. So for do what you want, be what you are. I mean, Cal isn't doing either of those things. He's not doing what he wants and he's not being who he is. And I think that really speaks to kind of the inauthenticity of his life. And kind of going on to the other song, Method of Modern Love, I was reading kind of some theories online about this as well and kind of the connection of the song to Cal. And the song was kind of, I mean, people were talking about how the song represented kind of timeless love, which also could be another thing for timeless music and why they integrated, you know, music from different decades. But there were a few lines that I really liked. And there was one I wrote down here where it said, do you know that it's a method of modern love? I've got the way we work. I've got the way we run. I do believe that I'm inclined to look ahead and not behind. And I feel like, you know, especially in that scene, the flashback scene where he kind of finds out that his girlfriend is pregnant in high school, he chooses to shift his, you know, view forward, right? He kind of, you know, suppresses that part of himself and that kind of part of him that he can't pursue, you know, his relationship with his friend, and kind of just moves forward and in authenticity. But yeah, and I think it was intentional. I think I agree with my mom that I think, I think it was very intentional. And I think, you know, authenticity is kind of Cal's whole thing, you know, or lack of it. His whole issue. Exactly. And I think the songs really played to that. And I like how in touch that was with this character. So.
Out
of touch. Wasn't out of touch.
Wow.
It was in touch.
I mean, it's
in
like, touch. I got stuck on this lyric from Method of Modern Love too, where I say, locked in a modern world, dreams are made of a different stuff. So, you know, Cal had dreams when he was a kid, right? Of, you know, sports and college and being with his friend and being a kid. And then all of a sudden he went from that to getting married and having a kid and becoming this whole other person that he had never planned to be. And now as an adult, he's trapped in this world, in this terrible world that he's built for himself, where he's doing terrible things, mind you. Like, I'm not saying he's a great guy. He's doing awful things, but he's built this sort of like layers and layers and layers and layers and layers of terribleness around him. And he's just trapped there. And I think that's why he finally hits that wall and is like, I can't do this anymore, and has that grand breakup with his family, where in the foyer with the fake penis, and you know, he explodes. I think there's something to, you know, bottling everything up. At some point it's all going to come out. How it comes out, where it comes out, you know, is complicated.
So do you have anything that you want to add? I'm
trying to collect my thoughts. I mean, you guys basically said it. But I'm just thinking about how, yeah, he was pretty trapped. Like he had like just finally kind of had that moment with his high school best friend when he found out that his girlfriend was pregnant, and then he was trapped, like fully trapped, because you know, this was something that it wasn't just gonna go away. Like that's his kid. He's creating life. So I think, like Hazel said, he chose to move forward and kind of, you know, start living this American dream of a life, because he thought that that's like, maybe if he did that, he would be happier than if he, you know, stayed with his high school best friend.
Do you guys think that in modern times, that flashback with Cal sticks, you know, the feeling of being closeted with your best friend and then making a decision? Do you think it's exactly the same, or do you think anything's different?
I think, well, I mean, I definitely do know people who have had, like, I mean, most people, like, I know people now that basically, I mean, in elementary school, lost their entire friend group because, you know, they got a crush on their best friend. And, you know, young kids are not, they're not very educated, and they, you know, parents don't really put in an effort to explain these kinds of things to their kids if it's not necessary. And so they were viewed as outcasts, and it was too hard. And so I know a lot of people who, you know, admitted their crush for their best friend in elementary school, and then once they were shut down, they went into middle school closeted, because that was something that was so hurtful that they didn't think it was worth it to come out.
And that is so sad to hear. I mean, I, you know, I live in San Francisco, and I'm so grateful to live here. And I think it is one of the, you know, safest and most supportive places for LGBTQI folks. And yet there is definitely still plenty of raging homophobia around. I think, you know, especially like when we grew up, you know, when Mary Kay and I were growing up, there was really, it was really, really hard for folks to come out. But getting back to the music for a second, I just wanted to say that In Excess song, Never Tear Us Apart, is just so freaking good.
That and song,
so heart wrenching.
Your heart out every time you hear it.
Oh my God, it rips your heart out.
Well, and plus it just means so much more now with everything that happened with him in his life and death and all of that. So yeah, it's a very sad song. And that goes back to, you know, to just show that the music is very intentionally chosen. You know, him dancing with his best friend in that bar to that song is like, you get the pain of it all. Like it really comes through. Like he's struggling. And, you know, his dad obviously was homophobic and was not, his dad knew what was going on, but wasn't, you know, supporting him. And then, you know, when he finds out that his girlfriend's pregnant and just bursts into tears at the end, it's like, oh, it's so heart-wrenching, even though.
Oh, that's what I was going to say. Like, you know, he makes this choice. He makes a choice that a lot of men wouldn't necessarily make. A lot of men, you know, walk away, right? Or like, or try to pressure their partner, you know, to terminate a pregnancy. Obviously I believe in a woman's right to choose. And so that, or a pregnant person's, pregnant capable person's right to choose. But some, you know, it sounded like this pregnant person wanted to keep that baby. And so, you know, he could have walked away. So a lot of men in the 90s certainly did. A lot of men of all times have.
Yes.
And so he kind of did this ethical thing, and then he kind of lived this double life. Did some kind of unethical things on the side. Although I'm just doing the cliff notes, because all I did was like watch little clips.
I mean, I think though, even on a greater, like if we pull out just a little bit for a second, like pretty much everyone I would say in the cast of Euphoria is struggling with some sort of identity issue, right? You know, and so that's, you know, Zendaya or Rue is struggling obviously with her addiction, but also the fact that she's a really sweet person and she's in love with this other person, and that's complicated. And, you know, everyone's dealing with their own stuff, and which I think is part of life, right? You know, and just remembering that you never know what other people are going through, and everyone's going through their own stuff, and it's not very often that you see exactly who someone is on the outside. Obviously, Cal is an extreme example of that. But, and I think too, maybe I identified with him a lot because of the age, because he is in our age group. And I remember knowing kids when we were in high school who did not come out, or who did and then went back in.
Oh, yeah.
And it always made me really sad, you know?
Yeah, Sandia High School in the late 80s, early 90s, not a very safe place to be queer.
No, not the best, not the best. Maxwell's, however,
a good place.
A good place.
Well, I mean, it's the time period, right?
Like, right.
It's not really anywhere is that safe.
Yeah. Right. And that's where, like, you know, that flashback, it's like, yeah, you know, there wasn't a good space there. Yeah. Okay. Well, you guys have illuminated a lot for me, and I was really, like, totally confused. And then I was also very skeptical about your theory, I'm going to say. But, you know, the three of you joined forces, and I'm going to say I'm convinced. And yeah. Not only convinced, brainwashed, I don't know. I might watch some more Euphoria and actually enjoy it. You know,
it's a very well put together show. I think it's interesting. You know, obviously people are always blown away that that Hazel's able to watch it with us, but we started watching all kinds of stuff with them. And for me, it's important as a parent to know what they're watching and to be watching what they're watching. And
there's no way my kids would ever want to watch anything like that with me.
Nope. Yeah. I mean, in this case, Sid won't do it. Like, they go in the other room and watch it alone. But then afterwards we talk about
But that's just because, like, there's so many emotions in Euphoria, and this is so weird. I like to talk to myself while I'm watching shows sometimes, especially with that much happening, because, like, I'm just trying to process what's happening. And so I'll just, like, mumble to myself sometimes, and I'll be like, I have a lot to think about while I'm watching the show. And so that's just, you know, I don't want to bother you guys.
Well, let me ask you guys a question, because I think about this, and especially with my work, you know, I work with a lot of young people who are using drugs. Like, of course, when I watch a show like this and I think about young people watching it and people like you, like, even though it portrays, you know, the downsides, it's definitely like, you know, the people who are using are very charismatic, they're very beautiful. And so I do wonder if there is, if you got what you guys think of, if there's any risk of sort of romanticizing, you know.
I wouldn't say romanticizing in Euphoria, because, you know, seeing what she's going through and how absolutely terrible it is just kind of outweighs whatever romanticizing there is happening. Like, you do see the highs, and the highs for her are high, but then you see the lows, which are, like, you know, when her mom is, like, trying to get her sober after this huge breakdown. And, you know, she's just throwing up. She's, like, sleeping on the floor of the bathroom. And, like, she's, like, shaking. She can't, like, move. She's constantly, like, kind of crying and whimpering. Like, I think that outweighs whatever romanticizing there is at the high parts of whatever she's going through. And obviously it's a show, so it's some parts are more dramatic, or, you know, whatever. But I think people mistake that for being romanticized, and I disagree.
Yeah, I think context is really important in this case. I think seeing the whole show from beginning to end, you get to see the high highs, and, like, you know, it's from her perspective, and that's really important to know. So you get to see the high highs, and then you get to see the low lows, and especially in those very specific episodes where she's interacting with her family and kind of falling apart. I think it's hard to watch, but I've never seen anything like that in my entire life. And I think it's brought a lot of awareness, at least for me. But I mean, all that said, you could say that parts of it are romanticizing it. But I think it all comes down to context and knowing that, like, that is how people feel when they're on drugs, and then when it's taken away.
Yeah. And I think that's one of the things we talk about a lot too, is one of for me personally, one of the reasons why I'm passionate about watching the shows that my kids watch is I want to know what they're ingesting, right? You know, and so I want to know, you know, is it, what's being romanticized about this, or maybe what's a little inaccurate? And obviously I don't know everything, but we've had several conversations while watching Euphoria that have kind of ended with like, yeah, I don't really think that's how that situation would have ended. I think it would have ended a lot worse than that. Yeah. But, you know, it's being able to recognize that, you know, that it is at the end of the day, television. Mm-hmm. And I do think that if you had children in certain situations, or if you personally, you know, your life was different, I think things could definitely be misunderstood if you don't have someone that's helping you decode it, right? Mm-hmm. So that's a big part of it for me, at least.
Mm-hmm. And plus you can decode all the Hall and Oates mysteries for them.
I'm telling you, the Hall and Oates mysteries go deep. Like, we could probably, if you watch the show, we could go deep on this, but I felt like it had to be addressed. People were talking about it, and you know, it is our duty to
it is our sacred duty to do these things. And it's been so great having you guys on the episode. Thank you for being our guests.
Having us.
Super fun. Us. Super fun. Yeah,
it's been a good time.
I have a lot to say about Euphoria. So if you ever need me back.
Yeah. Yeah. And if anybody okay. wants to connect with anybody, you can send us an email through the website, hollandoatespodcast.com. Or call
leave us a message at 1-800-gmail.com. Say I want to talk with a minor about Euphoria.
exactly. So I'm saying we've got questions, we've got
it. Leave it on the voicemail. No, well, the socials, you know, you guys might have to who knows what's going to happen with our enormous social media presence.
I'm here to tell you, I had an interaction with someone this morning on Twitter who posted about every time you go away, posted something inaccurate. And I had to clarify and then post our thing. They were like, I wonder why Hall and Oates chose to cover a Paul Young song. I was like,
Wrong. So wrong. Even though you know how I feel and you know my secret, which is that I prefer the Paul Young version.
Well, but it just
it's all about the sitar.
For a small callback, it made me think of Paul, how he used to talk about how he didn't want to be the Hall and Oates know-it-all at school. I was like, well, that's not actually accurate. That's exactly what I did on Twitter. I was like, excuse me, sir.
Why is NATO just popping in and out? What's happening?
It's the laughing boy himself.
Oh, scary.
So, you know, it was a good week. We got to dive into some stuff. The kids being introduced to the Hall and Oates. Well, not my kids.
Introduced
not your kids.
To Hall and Oates.
The kids, the other kids. You know what I mean? Oh, the collective
sure.
kids.
Sure.
Gen Z.
Gen Z. Is that
That's
what
right.
Mean? Zoomers.
Is that what you were?
Yeah, bring it to the cool. Zoomers.
Well, yeah, it's like a, you know, there's the boomers and we're the Zoomers because we run Zoom.
That's just like a nickname. We run Zoom, okay, Zoom. It's not because you're too fast, like superheroes.
No,
and we are bringing this in at under. It was under 45 minutes. We're 44. We're going to bring this to a neat close.
We're going to bring it to a neat close. I'm even going to be able to cut some stuff out, so we're actually going to be under that.
Oh, but leave in the stuff about giving the dogs their ears because that's important.
I will 100% leave the part.
I was on while you.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah. That's going on the podcast.
Oh yeah. It's gonna be
well, it's been real. Enjoy your week, and we will see you next week.
Do what you wanna, girl. You can be what you wanna. You can do what you want. You can